Hi everyone, my name is Cyril Filias. I'm the lead program learning and development at CERIC. And on behalf of all the CERIC team, I would like to welcome you to today's webinar. And today we are delighted to highlight a research project funded by CERIC in collaboration with Ironwood Consulting. This research aimed to explore how foundational concepts and skills introduced and developed by elementary school teachers intersect with career development. So the research also looked at identifying strategies and interventions that educators can use to foster these skills. And for this webinar, I'm pleased to be joined by the entire project team who will be with us today to talk more about their research and more importantly about their funding and the beautiful teaching toolkit they created. But before starting, I want to pay respect to the original people of the territory upon which I physically sit and acknowledge that I'm coming to you from Toronto. And Toronto has been for dozens of years the traditional land of the Huron-Wendat, the Petun, the Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabe, and the Mississauga Anishinaabe of New Credits. I acknowledge that the Indigenous peoples are the original stewards and caretakers of these lands and waters. And CERIC is committed to engaging Canada's career development community in this journey of reconciliation through our education and research work and collaboration. So we'd like to take the land acknowledgement as opportunity to share resources that you might find interesting to explore. So today I would like to share a guide produced by the Medicine Hat College that helps build further awareness around some aspect of the history of Indigenous community. So I will share and I will post the link on the chat shortly and invite anyone else who might have come across resources that they find interesting to share that in the chat as well. Now, let me briefly introduce CERIC and our support for your work. So CERIC is a charity focusing on career counseling and development in Canada. We offer CanAccess, the Canada largest career development conference. CareerWise.ca website, a site featuring top news and view in the field with a French version called orientation.ca, and the Canadian Journal of Career Development, which is free to access. We also host live webinars and provide training for your professional development, so you can explore all that at CEREC.ca website. And as many of our learning initiatives are shaped by your needs and feedback, this is just a kind heads up that a short survey will appear on your screen at the end of our session today. We'll welcome any feedback you may have regarding this webinar and regarding your future learning needs. So thank you in advance for your responses. Now, just a quick couple of housekeeping notes for today's webinar. So during the session, you can interact with your colleague directly on the Zoom chat, and you can also post your question to our presenter by using the Q&A function that you see on your screen. We'll have a Q&A session toward the end. And also note that this webinar is being recorded, so we'll provide you with French subtitle on the recording for our Francophone colleagues. Simply note that it might take up to 7 days for you to receive the recording and the copy of the slide through email. Now, I am thrilled to introduce you to our four presenters today. So Dr. Lauren Godden is our first presenter. Dr. Lauren Godden is a qualified teacher and educational researcher. She is the Fusion Skill Development National Lead at Carleton University and a part-time faculty lead at Yorkville University. She's a fellow of the Higher Education Academy in UK and serves on the board of directors of the Asia Pacific Career Development Association. Thank you, Lauren, for being here. Our second presenter today is Nikki Moore. Nikki Moore is a senior lecturer in career development at the International Center for Guidance Studies, University of Derby in UK. She's a fellow of the UK's Career Development Institute and a fellow of the National Institute of Career Education and Counseling and a senior fellow of the Higher Education Academy. Thank you, Nikki, for joining us from beautiful UK today in the evening time. Our third presenter today is Dr. Heather Nesbitt. Dr. Heather Nesbitt is an educator, researcher, and mother. She is an Ontario qualified primary junior teacher with over 15 years of experience at both primary and post-secondary levels. She is an adjunct assistant professor of the Faculty of Education at Queen's University and a seasonal faculty member of the School of Education at Trent University. Thank you, Heather, for being with us today. Last but not least, our last and fourth and last presenter today is Dr. Stephen Merchant. Dr. Stephen Merchant is an assistant adjunct professor of the Faculty of Education at Queen's University in Ontario, Canada, a former teacher, school administrator, and current father. Stephen researches the development and assessment of foundational skills such as collaboration, self-regulation, and work habits. CERIC has been honored to partner with this group of excellent experts, and we are so thrilled to have the entire group with us today to share more about their research and their projects. So let's not wait any longer. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Cyril, for the lovely introduction. And we're all really pleased that we can join everyone today, both attending here live and those of you watching the recording later on. And we are particularly excited to talk to you about the work that we've been doing and the teaching toolkit that we have developed. So Nikki, if you could change slides, please. So on our agenda for this webinar is to share the goals of the project with you, to talk about the supporting research that has framed our work, and that includes literature reviews that we undertook and also research that we completed ourselves. We're going to provide you with an introduction to the toolkit and talk about some big ideas and activities that are contained within the toolkit. And then finally, we'll share our next steps with you all and have some time for questions and answers. But as we go through the webinar, there is a Q&A function. You'll see that on the panel at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And we encourage you to post your questions in there as we move through, as they occur to you. And we will do our very best to respond to those all during the webinar, if possible. So without any further ado, we're going to get going with the content that we are going to share with you.
Thank you very much, Lorraine, for starting us off there. And it's a great pleasure to be talking to you all, my point of view, this afternoon. Now, we're all researchers here in the team. And so we're always curious about people's thinking about a lot of career-related aspects. And as we're talking about elementary school learning today, we thought we'd provide you with some questions to start you off on this journey with us. So what you can see on the screen are the questions, and we're going to ask you to answer these in the poll. Once we've done that, my colleague Stefan is going to...
So the purpose of the poll obviously is to, you know, engage you a little bit and get you the opportunity to have some input, but also many of these questions were questions that were on the surveys that we conducted as part of our research, right? The first question was not, obviously. We were expecting that most people who would sign up for a webinar like this would have been pretty supportive of career-related learning at any stage in life. But, you know, one of the concerns we had as a research group at the very beginning of this work was a fair amount of resistance. And because we were worried that especially, you know, elementary school teachers would be thinking, what are you doing trying to determine kids' life paths when they're in grade four? Like, this is ridiculous, right? And, you know, that's obviously not what we're trying to do. But I certainly understood some of the, you know, participants we had in our research who were a bit hesitant to think about career-related learning in elementary school. The next question, number two, about what grade level students should begin developing and understanding about careers in the world of work. You'll see later on when we show the data, this is one of the questions we had in our survey. There are some differences between the different groups we had responding to this question in terms of when people think it's appropriate to begin career education. You know, obviously, your answer to this question would depend in large part on how you define the term career. And that's one of the things we'll be looking at as we go through. Number three, who should be primarily responsible for educating grades 4 to 6 children about careers? this was an interesting one as well. you know, we could see parents as one of the popular options. You know, one of the things that comes out of our research, as well as the research of others, is that for a lot of kids in this age, the only careers they know about or the only jobs they know about are either ones that are plainly obvious in the community, such as a teacher or you know, police officer or something like that, or the job that their parents have. Mm-hmm. Guidance counselors is a great response. Not all schools have guidance counselors. Mm-hmm. And then the last one about how grade four students, 4 to 6 students should learn about career. We obviously received a big range of data on this one. One thing that's interesting with the responses here is, you know, you can see the most popular response option is through experiential or hands-on learning in the classroom. That was not necessarily the case for the survey respondents that we had. Hopefully we'll have a chance to share some of that. So I'm going to stop sharing these results and let's take a look at what we actually collected from the surveys and other data collections that we did.
Okay, so I'm just going to, before I hand over to Stefan to start looking at the actual research findings, what I wanted to do was to just start by thinking about why grades 4 to 6 are an important place to start this journey. And one of the aspects of the research that we conducted was a very extensive literature review, and you can find the literature reviews published separately on the CERIC website, in fact. One of the aspects that I was particularly interested in considering was the meaning of career and how people understood the word. And there are many definitions of career, but the one that seems to be the most prevailing is that career is about life, learning and work. So it's not just about work, but it's about three components: life, learning and work. And there's some quotes here, a quote from one of the participants in the research who kind of very eloquently explained this. So we think that this is a lifelong journey. And the grade 6 teacher confirmed this. She said, a lifelong journey one takes filled with different education and work experiences, using and identifying different knowledge, skills and personal qualities and characteristics that make a positive contribution to the work one is doing and the community one is living in. So what that actually shows us is that career is a very complex idea. That there's this sense of forward movement in it. There's a journey taking place, but this journey isn't just into a job, but through many different component parts of our lives. And in actual fact, when you think about your own career decisions, I challenge any one of you to think about the fact that you've made that in isolation. Most of us make decisions about career in the context of our families, our friends, our communities. And so it is a very complex idea. And of course, when it's complex, we need to start thinking fairly early about this. So, of course, what we know is that elementary school children are developing their skills and competencies, and these build their capacity for successful learning and positive, harmonious career and life outcomes. So when we talk about careers education, what we're not talking about is asking kids to choose a career path. That's definitely not what we're doing. What we're trying to instill is the notion that career-related learning can be seen as a mechanism that informs and supports a child to develop their sense of self and to develop a way of thinking about themselves in a very positive way with a meaningful identity. So this is far more than choosing a job. This is about developing yourself as a human being. Now, as I said, we've done plenty of desk-based research before we embarked on our survey work. And what research tells us is that from a very young age, children begin to think about their future. And I'm sure if you think about the kids around you that you know, they will have some questions about what they're going to do when they grow up, but they'll also start to be formulating ideas about what other people do when they grow up, how the world works and what people do when mom says she's going off to work, what that actually means. They start being curious about that and think about their own roles as adults in the future. So they begin to develop that notion of future and how their lives will spin out. So what we want to make sure you understand is that the toolkit that we've put together is based on the knowledge that children think about their future, the evidence base that's come from our review of the literature, extensive as it was, but also of our interaction with our own research participants. And what I'm going to do now is ask Stefan to start taking us through that research so you can understand how we've used that to build the toolkit. So, Stefan, over to you.
Okay, thank you, Nikki. So as you can see on the slide here, we had a fairly comprehensive approach to our data collection. And so, you know, the literature reviews, which have been mentioned already, you know, it's important for us to get an understanding of what's been done already and a deep understanding of the field. And this was done both sort of from an academic perspective, but also from a policy and curriculum perspective, looking at documents within ministries of education across Canada and even internationally. It doesn't say this on the slide, but we did this both in English and in French. And so, you know, this was a big effort that took us a couple of years. But, you know, as researchers, we are big fans of empirical data. And so we set about collecting our own data through these surveys, and we're going to share some of those results with you now. So let's move forward, Nikki. Now, Nikki mentioned that the lit reviews are available as separate publications on the CERIC website. And so, you know, when this presentation is available to you, you could just look at these titles here for an easy search, or you could probably just do the search for career development in children. We've also been publishing, as well as in academic journals and through CERIC, within professional journals, professional magazines, I guess I should say. And so these publications are within sort of the realm of the Canadian Association of Principals. We're also looking at publishing with school counselor magazines and you know, groups like that. All right, can we move on? There we go. Okay, so this slide here about the evolution of career thinking, this really, I think, comes out as one of the dominant themes of our findings. We're going to go through some specific research findings, but we found some age-based differences in terms of how people think about career. And essentially what we're finding is that as people get older, their notion or their idea of career tends to become more complex. And it's no longer just about a job, or, you know, working in an office or something like that. And it starts to involve things like interactions within the community, volunteering, education. You know, it just becomes a very nuanced and, like I said, complex concept. And so we're going to see that as we go through our data. But that's just kind of a big idea I'd like you to keep in mind as we discuss our research. Okay, we move to the next one. Okay, so all of you were, or most of you were kind enough to answer this question. And as we saw, you know, we had our poll results. This is what we actually collected. And so when we surveyed practicing teachers, the most common response we got was grades 2 to 3, which is actually slightly younger than the grade range that this research is targeted at, right? When we surveyed pre-service teachers, so pre-service teachers are people who are currently doing their teacher education in a Bachelor of Education program, we could see that for them, so these people would be sort of between, let's say, 20, 22 years old, they had a much older response. And they're saying, no, career-related learning should begin, you know, kind of in early adolescence, you know, somewhere around grade 8, grade 9, somewhere in there, right? And then when we interviewed students, and when we say students here, we really mean kids who are in grades 4 to 6. This was an interesting finding because they were kind of all over the map. And you know, in some ways, maybe the question wasn't even appropriate for them in terms of their developmental level. But what was interesting about the responses to the survey question was, you know, as you could see, 3/4 of them thought that learning about careers, and keep in mind, they define career as job, but they thought this kind of learning was really interesting. All right, can we go to the next one? So when we talk about this notion of career, you know, you could see these are some examples of writing we got from our participants. Practicing teachers, you know, they tended to give these kind of holistic, and like I said, fairly complex and nuanced responses as to what career might mean. And for these people, it went beyond just a job, right? Let's go to the next group, Nikki. When we looked at the pre-service teachers, so again, these are people, you know, they're maybe 20 years old-ish. You can see what we said was that 79% of them, when they asked to define the term career, they came up with something that's work or a job, right? And, you know, when you look at these responses, it's not just that they're shorter than what the practicing teachers gave us, but they really are focused on paid work. Let's go to the next one. Yeah, we can see, I mean, there, you know, this wasn't all of them. Like I said, you know, 79% kind of had this paid work perspective. There were some others that did have more nuanced view. Okay, let's see what we got next. So when we talked to the kids in grades 4 to 6, when we surveyed them, job was pretty much the word that came up all the time. You know, the response we see in the middle that's a little more sophisticated, it says a job profession by someone that has helped them build a good life. And so there is some kind of a connection for this student between a job and, you know, the broader aspects of their life. But by and large, the grade 4 to 6 students that we survey, they just equate a career with a job and pretty much nothing more. Parents were an interesting group, and I say that because the parents, their responses to, you know, defining the term career were very similar to the teachers. And obviously some parents are teachers and some teachers are parents, and so there's overlap between those two groups. But it was interesting to see how they also typically had a fairly, you know, I'll say holistic and complex notion of career that went beyond paid work. And so for us as researchers, you know, the trend that we noticed is that it does appear that as people get older and have more experience with the world, their notion of career changes to one that is more complex. All right. Now, this was an interesting question for us because we kind of wanted to know what parents thought about career education or career-related learning for kids in grades 4 to 6, because it is kind of an interesting time. You know, they're coming towards the end of childhood and just at the very beginning of adolescence, right? And so, you know, looking at the results here, you can see that by and large, you know, parents are supportive of career-related education in grades 4 to 6. The last two items on this slide, I think, are kind of interesting. So you have about 70% of parents saying, oh, my kids ask about this. They ask about jobs. They ask about careers. They ask about work. And then 90% of parents are saying, I talk about this with my children, right? And the fact that 90% of parents are saying, I talk about this with children, indicates this is of some importance to parents and something they value. Let's move on to the next one. Oh, yes, the teachers. Oh, no, can we go back, Nikki? Sorry, everyone. I wanted to compare this with the teachers. Because you notice the data, I mean, they're not exactly the same, but they're fairly similar. But notice that 100% of our teacher respondents said they talk about jobs, careers, and work within their classroom, right? So when, you know, we phrased the question slightly different for the parent and teacher survey. So the teacher survey didn't say my children. It said, you know, I talk about jobs, careers, and work in my teaching or in my classroom. But, you know, this is something that is already happening. And so that was an interesting finding for us. You know, it's not like we're trying to you know, initiate or instigate career-related learning in elementary school. It's already happening. Okay, thank you, Nikki. Let's go to the next one. There's a few things that are interesting here for me. So you can see that we've starred some of the responses that had, you know, really high percentages of agreement. And so I'll say the third single star, the skills needed to do well at school are similar to those needed to do well in adulthood, is a really interesting one, because it suggests that there's a pretty good alignment between what's happening in school and you know, what you need to do well in school versus what you need to do well in life, right? The one with two stars that says elementary teachers play a vital role in developing career-related skills, okay, this is parents who said this, right? And so parents think that, you know, teachers have an absolute vital role in developing career-related skills. So do teachers, by the way. That's not just the parents. The other thing that was interesting is you could see the blue arrow on the right-hand side of the slide. It says, my child tells me about interesting jobs or careers they've learned about at school. Only 28% of parents agreed with this. And if you remember the previous slide, we had 100% of teachers saying they talk about this in their classroom. Those of you who are parents know that kids don't always talk at home about the stuff they learned at school, and that might be part of this disparity. But it certainly was an interesting contrast for us, where we had all of our teachers saying, I talk about careers, I talk about the world of work in my classroom. And we had parents saying, I hardly ever hear about this from my kids. Okay, let's go to the next one. This slide here, we asked our survey participants to talk about, you know, what are the things we really value? And you could see we've framed this particular question as jobs. And, you know, this response here is from the survey we did with business and industry groups and partners. And you can see that what they've put is, you know, being happy and making a positive contribution to the community, right? And then at the bottom, we have, you know, staying close to home or taking a job that's sort of what your family wants you to do, right? If we go to the next slide, Nikki. So if we look at what parents said, well, it's pretty darn similar, right? And again, you know, some parents would be members of our business and industry groups, and members of our business and industry groups can also be parents. And so maybe, you know, because there's overlap between those two groups, it's not surprising that these are different. Lorraine and I have talked about this before. We think there's a cultural component to this. And then if we repeated this survey in different countries around the world, we would probably not get the same results. Right. But our survey respondents were from Canada. And so we have, you know, a strong Canadian culture component to these responses. All right, let's go to the next one. This is what the kids thought. And once again, I want to remind you, this is grades 4 to 6. That's how old the kids are for these survey respondents. If the responses were from kids outside of that age range, we just didn't include them in our data. And so we've got being happy, which is same as the parents and the industry groups. Going to a good school or university came out as number 2, which I thought was interesting and likely reflects, you know, the messages that a lot of kids are getting from their teachers and from their parents about the importance of school, right? It was interesting to see that travel the world came out lowest for the students. Not really sure why that might be. You know, it just may be that if you're in grade 4, you're 10 years old, your travel experiences may be fairly limited at that point. And you may not fully understand some of the benefits that travel can bring. Okay, let's go to the next one. So this survey question here is, What we asked was, we had a long list of skills, and these skills were developed from sort of skills frameworks. And we said to our different, you know, participant groups, which of these skills are most important, you know, for kids to be developing in grades 4 to 6? And you could see there's some overlap across the four groups and some differences, right? When we looked at the educators, so that would be practicing teachers, you know, number one came out as writing. Perhaps this is not surprising. Literacy is a very strong focus area in a lot of elementary schools. And so writing and communication, that would make sense, right? When we looked at parents, communication and writing also came out as the top two. Speaking as a parent, and I'm sure some of you can be sympathetic, communication with your kids is vital to having a good relationship. So I could see why parents would say, yep, you know, communication is number one. The business and industry partners, you know, they put responsibility as number one, and you can see that did not crack the top five for the other three groups. Well, it came in as number five for the pre-service teachers. But it's not difficult to imagine that for an employer, you know, one of the things they're looking for in their employees is someone who comes to work on time, you know, fulfills their obligations or their duties in a responsible manner, right? And so, you know, when we look at this list of skills here, none of them would be considered undesirable, right? These are all things that we would hope, you know, Canadian children and children across the world would develop. But it was interesting just to see kind of where the emphasis might be in terms of what different groups thought was most important. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's go to the next one. This one was kind of interesting. We asked, you know, the teachers said, hey, what is it you actually devote the most time to in your classroom? And you could see there was a four-way tie, which is, I thought, kind of maybe just coincidental, but literacy and numeracy, we expected those to be very high up. That's kind of the classic, you know, what we expect elementary teachers to be developing in school. Creativity, responsibility, and the fact that teachers see themselves as devoting equal time to those two skills, I thought was very interesting, right? The other thing that came out as interesting for us was the 0% for digital skills, right? And this particular survey question did not have sort of a follow-up question that said, hey, can you explain your response? So we don't know why teachers are saying, you know, I'm not devoting a lot of time to this. And so it may be something like they think their kids will develop this later on. It may be sort of a reaction to, you know, worries about too much screen time. Maybe they think it's being developed at home. Or maybe they just think these other skills are, you know, they are more foundational. And so that's where the time needs to be spent. Okay, let's move on. When we looked or asked people to talk about what are appropriate ways for, you know, for kids to be learning these skills, I'm going to ask you to look at the third line, because amongst our group here today in the classroom through experiential or hands-on learning, our participants today, 57% of you said, this is the way to do it. And look how high that is compared to what our survey respondents said, right? I thought it was interesting that teachers, so that's the first column, kind of the peach colored column. If you look at the very first line, it says in the classroom using teacher directed lessons. So teacher directed lessons was more popular than hands-on or experiential learning. And I thought that was an interesting finding, right? You could see it's the opposite for parents. Parents rated the experiential hands-on learning. They thought, you know, that was better than, you know, teacher directed lessons, right? We can also see that compared to teachers, parents rated extracurricular activities and being at home with the family more highly than the teachers did. That may not be surprising. One of the things, you know, that I say about teaching, I used to be a teacher. In fact, all four of us did. I said, you know, when I was a teacher, the only place I saw my students was at school. And as a parent, the only place I see my kids, well, I see my kids everywhere except at school. And so, you know, teachers and parents kind of get two different versions or get to see their kids in two different places. And so that may account for some of these differences. All right, let's go to the next one. This slide here, we asked teachers, okay, how are you engaging with career-related learning? What are you actually doing in your classroom to make this happen? And you could see the number one response was YouTube videos, right? And for us, not just as researchers, but as educators, this was really, an impetus or a motivation to develop a hands-on and practical teaching toolkit that will, you know, allow teachers to go beyond, here's a cool video on whatever it might be, right? We could see the second most common teaching strategy for teaching career-related learning was inviting guest speakers. This was a distant second, not surprising. Arranging for a guest speaker to come to the class is a lot more work than finding a video on YouTube, right? We did have a lot of other teaching strategies that were mentioned, but they tended to be mentioned by, you know, one or two survey respondents. When we looked for patterns in the data, we just didn't find any. Again, that may not be surprising because it's very likely that the teachers are engaging with this in a way that makes sense based upon their teaching context, their teaching style, the kids in front of them, and all those types of factors. Okay, Nikki, I think the next slide is you. Let's see. Yes, it is. All right, Nikki's going to talk about the toolkit.
Sorry. Thank you very much, Stefan, and thank you very much for taking us through all that data. It certainly tells us some very interesting stories. And as Stefan said, some of the responses to the questions that we made really inspired us to want to create a teaching toolkit, a practical toolkit, which would support educators maybe to think about this differently and to help them become innovative and creative in this regard. And so here is our toolkit. And I have to say, I think we're all grinning at this point because we're so thrilled to see it in publication. And really wanted to thank CERIC for sponsoring the beautiful graphics in the document. Now, you can buy the book from Amazon, but it's also available from the CERIC website as a downloadable PDF. And we do encourage you to do one of those two actions and get your own copy of this so you can see what we're enthusing about. But anyway, exploring possibilities, journeying through career-related learning in grades 4 to 6, a teaching toolkit. Now, the toolkit, we just wanted to give you a high-level view of what this was about. And what we hope the toolkit does is to take you on a journey, not just to career journey, but a journey of professional development, which allows you to explore effective career-related learning and what that might look like in your own particular context. As we started off by saying, there has been dissent about this project. People are very worried about starting to introduce this idea of career with such young children. But hopefully by reading the book, you'll have your fears completely dispelled about this. The book highlights valuable career-related contributions, which are already being made across Canada. And it helps to inform and consolidate teaching and work with students through this lens of career-related learning. So we were keen to point out that we use the concept of journey, both as a vision for children's career development, but also as a metaphor for your own learning journey. I've put this picture of a canoe up here because this is actually an image that CERIC uses around the concept of career, and we wanted to continue to reinforce that image with people. So this is the structure of the book. We do a thorough introduction to why the book is important and how you can actually use the book. So just to reinforce, this isn't just a book of activities for kids, but it's also a book which will help you understand why these activities are important and to help you think about how you'll apply them. And the second chapter, talking about career, one very close to my heart, because this explores the different ways that we can conceptualize career and use that idea with young people. It explores different views of career and how you can actually start to develop the concept with young people in a way which expands that view of not just about job, but a more complex idea. In chapter three, we look at how the nurturing and development of foundation skills is integral to good career learning and development. We then look at the notion that it's not just a classroom teacher's responsibility to do this. We've called chapter four, It Takes a Village. And this explores need for good collaboration and community-based approaches and how elementary schools can be at the very heart, the centre of this movement to develop young people's foundation skills with a view to supporting their future career development. Of course, that includes parents, it includes businesses, and it includes other community-based players, so an important chapter. Chapter five looks at the curriculum framework that exists to support career-related learning. Chapter six looks at how you can embed career-related learning within career development activities. And chapter seven talks about a conclusion to all of the work that we've set out within the toolkit. Now, I just wanted to explain how each of those chapters are broken down as well, because they don't just introduce activities. They start, as you can see on the left-hand side of the screen, referring to the journey that you'll be on. Why will you be reading the chapter? Why is it important? What do you need to think about? How the chapter comes to life in your classroom? And this actually provides you with some great activities and what have you within that section. Of course, what we need to show is that these have had an impact, all of this thinking and activities. So we think about evaluating the journey that you're on as well, thinking about how you can measure the impact of all of these things. And one of the key components here as well is the reflection on your journey. Excuse me, let me just take a drink. And what we know is that professionals are all kind of encouraged to undertake reflective practice, and we give you some hints and tips for doing that within each of the chapters. Excuse me. So I'm going to ask Heather now to take over and start talking about some big ideas while I quietly cough with my microphone off. So over to you, Heather.
Thanks, Nikki. To help give you an idea of what is in our toolkit, we wanted to share four big ideas with you, and we'll move through these ideas fairly quickly. I'm just watching the clock. So let's take a journey. So the first big idea that we wanted to share was the idea that career-related learning and skill development needs to be developmentally appropriate. So at this age and stage in life, it is not about picking a job. And we've emphasized that already. Rather, it is about learning about oneself in the world. And we really want to emphasize that career-related learning and skill development in grade 4 to 6 is really about meeting students where they are at. It's about helping to develop foundational skills, interests, passions, confidence, self-efficacy. It's about being inquisitive and curious. It's about learning about environments and communities, trying new things and taking positive risks, building relationships, asking questions, solving problems, and overcoming challenges. It's about feeling a sense of accomplishment and really learning about navigating life. You can go to the next slide. The second big idea that we wanted to share is this idea that career-related learning and skill development can take place through a spectrum of opportunities. There's not a one-size-fits-all approach, and nor should there be. Rather, we encourage educators to really embrace this spectrum and incorporate a variety of teacher-directed and student-directed experiences and activities, as well as formal and informal learning opportunities. And throughout this experience, these experiences, students can be viewed and empowered as partners and co-creators of learning. So at the bottom of the slide here, you can see the spectrum with emergent unstructured experiences kind of on one end, and that encapsulates things like free play. And then at the other end, we have explicit structured experiences, and those are more those teacher-directed lessons. But career-related learning and skill development can happen in many different ways and can fall across this spectrum. One of the ways that we're helping educators in our toolkit to be able to do this is through sharing a variety of activities. So at the end of chapters, we've shared several related activities, and they're designed for grade 4 to 6 students, but they can easily be adapted for older or younger students. And they're written in a way that really encourages teachers to use them as a starting point, but also be able to adapt them to fit the needs of their students and also adapt them to fit your local context. You can go to the next slide. So this is just an example of an activity. This is a matching game where students are encouraged to match skill cards with experiences and try to make those connections between life experiences and what kind of skills are necessary and needed, and also what you're developing. You can go to the next slide. This is another example, a careers terminology music quiz. And this is another fun activity and a great way to get conversations started. We were going to give you some time to sort of do this music quiz, but just watching the clock, I'm going to toss it out to you and perhaps you can ponder this for the day. So our music terminology quiz, there are many popular songs that feature different jobs and career-related terminology, either in the lyrics or the title. And perhaps as you move through your day beyond this webinar, you can see how many you can think of.
Maybe they could put them in the chat too.
Well, you can pop them in the chat as well. Yeah. And I'll pass it over to Lorraine.
Thank you, Heather. And so the third big idea is that we know that elementary schools play a big role within their community, and career-related learning is exactly the same. Your community can be an amazing resource when you're doing career-related work with young children. And so we've encouraged that approach, and we've put lots of hints and tips within the toolkit on how, you know, you can go about this in different ways. Of course, every school's community varies and does, you know, it present different opportunities. Some have more opportunities than others, so we realize that. So to compensate, there's a great role for technology here. Using things like Google Maps and Google Earth and virtual school trips allows you to undertake work with your young students that takes them beyond the four walls of their classroom. So we've built activities around this, and we've also discussed how to go about building partnerships within your community and how to capitalize on that third big idea. So if you can move on, please, Nikki. And the other big idea that we wanted to really highlight today is how much how we've constructed the toolkit aligns with existing practice that we are seeing within our elementary schools. There is so much valuable work being done that helps young children to prepare for their futures, but we feel that it's not always acknowledged or seen through that career development lens. And so we hope that the toolkit just sharpens that lens for folks and enables, you know, the really valuable work to be highlighted and showcased. We also highlight throughout this big idea, in that you're not doing this alone. There is lots of relevant curriculum out there. As we said at the outset of this presentation, career-related learning does exist in our curriculum, it exists in our schools. So we've pointed those towards folks, and we've highlighted some relevant curriculum and policy documents within the toolkit. and how pedagogy and practice examples can be seen within those documents. And we've also encouraged folks to think beyond your own jurisdiction, because some, you know, some areas have slightly more refined policies and curriculum than others, and there are still lots of pieces in there that are eminently transferable across different geographic regions. So what we hope is that this section of the toolkit is going to provide some resources and support for those that are doing this valuable work in schools. And we've also pointed to the wider career development field as well. And so folks can see where they're situated within that broader area of practice. I think this is important because often when we're teaching in a classroom, we feel alone, we feel isolated. So we hope that the teaching toolkit becomes a great accompanying resource where it can point folks to other sources of information and relevance that can really help students to, you know, to make the most of their career-related learning. We have really tried to emphasize that this is well aligned with all of the practice that happens in elementary schools. We are absolutely not recommending that jobs are prescribed for very young children, rather that children are supported in building skills that help them to become effective learners, and that that in turn translates to them making effective and smooth transitions and supports their ongoing learning. Career-related learning can be aligned with any subject and topic area. So there's so much freedom here and so much possibility with what you can do with your work when you're supporting young children in this subject area. And so, you know, that's a really important piece. And once again, like I say, it's viewing current practice through that lens of career-related learning and skill development.
Okay, I think it's over to me very briefly, Lorraine. And as we suggested in our approach to the toolkit, there's plenty of opportunity for reflection. Now, we're not going to be able to give you much time to do this. We're going to have to move on. But whilst Lorraine is talking during the next slide, we can ask you to be thinking about this question. So we've set out some ideas, some big ideas for you today. And we'd like you to think about how these big ideas can be explored in your practice, how it will change the practice that you're currently involved in. What will your next steps be? So, of course, we want to hear about that. The best way we can do that is to ask you to be putting some ideas in the chat so that we can capture those and view them after the webinar's concluded. It would be grateful if you could do that for us. So, as I say, do that while Lorraine is talking. And Lorraine, I'm going to pass immediately back to you now because the time is really pressing. So here's the next slide on our next steps.
Yes. Thank you, Nikki. Our next steps, at the moment, we're working really hard to disseminate the availability of this toolkit. And also, you know, that's through conferences, through this webinar, through other dissemination activities that we're taking part in. We, as we started out by saying, we're researchers, we're always interested in more data. So now that we have this toolkit available, we are very keen to see how folks are interacting with the toolkit. If any of you are interested in working with us on producing some case studies of how you might be using the toolkit, then that would be fabulous. We would absolutely love to hear from you. And of course, there's the question, we've been asked this before. Are we interested in more grades, in producing toolkits for more grades? Yes, we are. we're very excited about doing this work. We're so thrilled with the response that we've had. And I know that some of you are already indicating in the chat that you're interested in getting involved in working with us further here. We will shortly be posting our email addresses. So please drop us an email and let us know. And we will also share this chat amongst ourselves and save your responses so that we can follow up with you so that we can take this work forward together. This is incredibly important work. So we're thrilled to have as many of you attending as has been. I know we're left with very little time for questions, but we've had a lovely rich amount of questions as we've gone through. If we haven't answered your question, or if you have additional questions, you are very, very welcome to reach out and email us. And equally, for those who you are watching the recorded version, we welcome that interaction from you as well. So if you have any questions with us, please do follow up. I'd like to finish just by saying thank you all very much for your participation today and for coming to listen to our webinar. We very much appreciate all of you. Thank you.
Well, Stefan, Nikki, Lauren, and Heather, thank you to all of you for this fantastic session. It was so interesting to get a chance to learn more about the research. I have to say that as a parent myself, I found very intriguing to see the distinction of like how parents, educator, and students were seeing the career-related learning. Very interesting, and I loved how you were able to walk us through some extract of the toolkits and the great content, the amazing content you have put together. So I thank you very much for this session, and I will really encourage anyone who is interested in getting the book to visit our website. You can have an access, you can download it for free. You can also order a hard copy through Amazon. So you can find that at CERIC.ca/possibility. Now, I also just before officially closing, I also want to take just a quick minute to let you know about other excellent learning opportunity happening at CERIC. So we are back on Monday with another great webinar related to a project that CERIC funded. You can join us at 4 p.m. Eastern time to learn more about the new CERIC book, Practice Principle, Career Theories and Model at Work, and the new Career Practice Reflection Guide that is included in the book. And outside of next week, we'll also have other excellent webinar on the Canada's Career Development Landscape Project, on the social determinant of mental health, and on how to use AI tool to improve career services. So you can learn more about all of the upcoming webinars, as well as our certificate program on the intersectional approach to supporting career development done in partnership with CASE, the Canadian Association for Supported Employment, by visiting our website at CERIC.ca/events. Now, with all that, let me now officially close the webinar. Thank you again so much to you, Lauren, Nikki, Heather, and Stefan. I'm looking at you. And thank you so much for your great engagement throughout the webinar. I saw a lot of comments and questions, and our panelists and presenters did an amazing job at answering all of them. But I encourage you to reach out to them. They will really welcome your question and comment. Thank you for joining us today, and I hope to see you at another learning opportunity very soon. Have a good weekend.